You're listening to KPFT HD1 90.1 on your FM dial. If you're down in Galveston, pick us up at 89.5 and our friends in Huntsville, Texas and beyond, 89.7. It's 7 o'clock. It's time for Songwriter Studio. I am your host, Tom Tranchilla, and it's my pleasure and honor to bring on the Songwriter Studio tonight the great, the honorary Gino Vannelli, composer, poet, producer, arranger, band leader. And along with Gino, we're bringing in Joe Flores, who will be hosting Gino Vannelli at his brand new Woodlands Ego Cuisine and Music venue. So thank you both so much for spending an hour on Songwriter Studio with us this evening.
You're welcome.
Good to be with you, Tom. This is Gino.
Gino, thanks a lot for phoning in, and big thanks to your brother Ross for setting this up, and John in Houston for getting the wheels rolling, and you, Joe, for letting us take advantage of this hour. And before we jump into the interview with Gino, which is going to be extensive, why don't you tell us a little bit about the brand new venue and your first major concert with Gino Vannelli? Go ahead.
Yes, sir. It's a venue up in the Conroe area, Woodlands area. It's a nice part of Houston. You know, I've been in the music business for about 30 or 40 years as a musician, studio owner, producer, promoter. And so the venues I've had, you know, being a musician is that we're trying to bring a diverse type music to our venue. The venue, first of all, seats about 540 people. It's a very intimate setting. A lot of your major acts are kind of digging, coming into a little bit smaller area. We've got state-of-the-art sound, lighting, and it's a very good venue. One of the deals is every seat in the house is a good seat. We also offer fine dining in the evening, and we're also open for lunch. Very comfortable environment. You know, when you walk into my place, it's kind of like, you know, you walk in and it feels like music. I like to tell people it's a venue made by musicians for musicians. I mean, man, it's such an honor. I've been a Gino Vannelli fan as a guitarist myself all my life. I mean, I'm thinking, man, next time we get going, I'd love to try to get Gino Vannelli in there. So, you know, thank God it's happening now. I spoke to the Vannellis several years ago when I had another venue called Crescent Moon Live. At the time, I was speaking with Ross, Gino's brother, but I just couldn't put it together. My venue just wasn't big enough yet. But as of right now, I think, you know, the buzz around Mr. Vannelli is going awesome. I know it's going to be a good show, perfect seating, good drinks, good food, and very good environment. So I'm really looking forward to this show. And, Gino, I really appreciate you giving me this opportunity to, you know, come in that night and perform for us. Really looking forward to it.
So am I, Joe.
Gino, I've been a fan of yours since the early 70s. This is, I believe, your 50 or 51st year as a recording artist, and I was purchasing vinyl album of yours. In the early days, I think Brother to Brother got worn clean through by the needle playing it so much. And when your brother Ross sent me a copy of the Live in L.A., it's what a great record. The musicians you've got touring with you right now are just top-notch. We will be talking a little bit about them, but before we jump into that, I do want to play Brother to Brother. This is your live version, the extended version off the Live in L.A. album, and the sax work you've got on this with Patrick Lamb and the guitar work with Jay are just off the charts excellent. Before we go ahead and spin this song, why don't you talk about your current lineup and how you chose these touring artists? Go ahead.
Well, it took a bit because I live up in the Oregon area near Portland, and most of the musicians are from this area. In fact, right now, all of them, some of them have moved from Los Angeles. I mean, Reinhard Meltz is a unique kind of drummer. His father really got him into Afro-Cuban stuff. His father's a percussionist. So Ryan approaches the drums really in a different way. I mean, his fills and his feel are not, I would say, standard at all. So he's got this Latin-esque, you know, approach to his playing. And of course, David Goldblatt on keyboard, originally from Los Angeles, now is with us. He lives up here in Portland. Damian Erskine on bass. His uncle is Erskine that played with Weather Report. Jay, of course, great guitar player, lives up here in Portland. And Pat, I've moved to Miami, but he's still with us. And he does all the dates with us. That's the core of the group. We have other people that tour with us too, monitor engineers and so on. And Ross does the front house sound. Everybody's really committed. And that's what I look for. Yesterday, Damien, the bass player, brought it to my attention. We just did a video for the new single, the new album coming out. He says, you know, I've been with you for 15 years. I says, geez, I must be having a good time.
Yeah, he's also an educator, I read, quite accomplished.
Yeah, he is. And so, you know, the guys never balk at doing rehearsals and keeping the show fresh and learning a new song and so on and so forth. So this is why we're together after all these years.
Gino, this Live in L.A. album is just outstanding. The recording quality sounds like a live in-studio project, and it is so tight between the band and the recording quality. This could definitely be on a regular rotation in anybody's music. Let's go ahead and listen to Brother, Brother. Of course, this was the title track of your 1978 release, Brother to Brother, and this is the long version, and it is just killer. Gino Vannelli from Live in L.A. This is Brother to Brother.
Right.
From the brand new album, Live in L.A., Gino Vannelli, the title track of his Brother to Brother 1978 release. Long version. Gino, your falsetto in this track is just off the charts. The guitar playing with Jay, and I can't say enough about Patrick Lamb's just outstanding saxophone player. You know, he used to play with Diana Shore, one of my favorite jazz singers.
Yeah, I know the whole band was just rocking on that. I mean, Ryan did a very unique kind of drum solo against the 6/8 feel in the middle section. I mean, it's kind of an example of us like being respectful of the old arrangements and yet taking it to a new level after all these years. I mean, you got to do something different. So when people come and see this show, they're not just going to see a remake of the CDs. We do respect what was done on the CDs, so we take that and take it a step further, as you can hear with the live version of Brother to Brother.
And I'm assuming we're going to hear some of these jams in your live show, because the way you guys are cooking on Brother to Brother, you could have stretched that out for an hour and it would not have been boring. Just a superb job.
It's really that way with all the songs. You know, there are certain things about the songs that I really dig, even though some of them are 40 or 50 years old. And I keep the essence. I don't like to mangle the song so that people don't recognize it. People do recognize it, but it's like sometimes it takes a beat for them to go, oh. Of course, we have a horn section with us live. And like, for instance, in Nightwalker, there's a part that all that was done with strings in 1980. But now we add a horn section doing that line, and it really strengthens the line. It's even more dense sounding. Things of that nature that we do live.
Looking forward to the show again. You're going to be there on February 14th. This will be Valentine's Day at Joe's new venue. And I will be there with my engineer and our wives, and we are looking forward to the show. Let's talk about the next track we've got selected. And I wanted to go back a little bit on this, Gino, People Gotta Move. This was off a 1974 release. The keyboards on this are just fantastic. I'm assuming David's doing do the keyboards on this one. I know you have several keyboardists on this live record.
Yes. You know, of course, that was a keyboard song, you know, so, you know, we take precautions. But we take the arrangement out to a different place in the middle section of it. And the solo is very unique. And we're true to that horn arrangement. I'll tell you a very silly little thing about that song. I wrote it when I was 18 years old. At the time, I had a girlfriend, and her name was Anne, and her father didn't really approve of me very much, and he thought I was sort of a wastrel or wandering musicians that would go nowhere. I was always talking about making it someday, and so she said to me one day, "Why don't you finish college and get a real job?"
Right.
I said, Anne, I said, I'm going to go home tonight and I'm going to write you a song that's going to be a top 10 song. And she just kind of smirked. And that night I went home on my flamenco nylon string guitar and I wrote People Gotta Move. And I knew it was a little bit of in some ways, a silly ditty, but in some ways very hooky and catchy and all those things. And so I went back to see her the night after school. And I said, I got a song for you to hear. I said, I think this is going to be the first song that's going to make me famous. So I started on the guitar. People come on and do it right. And she's just kind of head tilted going, And her father just, and her father walked in. And as he walked in, I stopped and I said, can you just hear the brass going, bup, bo-dap, bup. And her father kind of wagged his finger at her, clicking his tongue, saying, don't fool around with this guy.
He's bad news.
Did he ever accept you?
He did eventually. I got a record deal with A&M.
Awesome.
Had some meat on it. He was like, well, congratulations.
Yeah. Now, huh?
Gino, if you're just tuning in, Gino Vannelli's our guest on Songwriter Studio. And we're discussing his upcoming show at Ego in the Woodlands, and he will be playing on Valentine's Day night I'm going to play this cut off his Live in L.A. album, People Gotta Move, 1974, off of the powerful People. This is the live version, and I'm especially fond of the fantastic keys, drums, and guitar work on this. The arrangements you put together on this live album are just off the charts. Gino Vannelli, let's listen to that track right now. People Gotta Move off the Live in L.A. Gino Vannelli, what a great track. Especially love the keyboards on this as well as the guitar work. We talked a little bit about Jay. Is his last name pronounced Coder?
Yes, it is.
What a great player. He was with Chick Corea for a while, Herbie Hancock. And this kind of surprised me, was actually playing with the Steve Miller Band for a while.
He was.
Very diverse player.
Really?
A great guitar player, and it's actually a great person to be with, too, on stage. He's wonderful.
You recorded this album at, is it the Saban Theater in Beverly Hills?
Yep, the Saban Theater, I think it was either 14, 15, 6, 7 years ago. Ross, I think, had 12 cameras there and all that, so the visual part turned out pretty good, too.
You know, you had such a string of hits back there in the late 70s and early 80s. Like I said, I was buying your vinyl and just wearing them out at home. And just there was nothing off the records I didn't like. So when I pulled this one up, I Just Want to Stop, of course, one of your greatest hits. It was actually written by Ross, your brother, and added to the Brother to Brother album. Could you go into depth a little bit on the recording process? Go ahead.
That was a bit of a challenge because I knew it was a hit song when Ross played it for me. And the thing was, you know, he played it for me on the guitar. So tried to envision it, you know, how I could really distribute all the notes and what's behind and in between the notes. At that time, to Mark Cranny on the drums, to Jimmy Haslip on the bass, Joe, my keyboardist, and Carlos Rios on the drums. On the guitar. And we rehearsed it in Joe's garage for a while until we got that kind of magic that we needed to get from it. But all the while, I knew it was a hit song. I knew it was a special song. But it was the difficulty was in trying to capture it with our four or five piece combo. And in those days, we would have a cassette tape with us and be taping our rehearsals. And we went through a lot of kinds of arrangements of I Just Want to Stop before we landed on what people hear on the 1978 version. And of course, this version is a little bit of a takeoff from the 1978 version, you know, basic same structure and format, but even a little bit deeper, I think. And I still enjoy singing it after all these years.
Wonderful song. I know this is one of my wife's favorites as well. I do want to ask you before we spin this song, are there two keyboards going on here?
There's, there's a pad, you know, in the background, but basically it's just one keyboard, you know, that a Rhodes kind of sound, and that's really what it is. What you're hearing in the back is just like this kind of, I don't know, this drone kind of pad that's sequenced in to the whole program. But there's basically one keyboard.
Again, Patrick Lamb, the sax work on this is just over the top. What a great job. Excellent recording.
I know. That was Ernie Watts' solo. When he came into the studio to do his solo, I hadn't heard. I knew that he played with a lot of, you know, heavyweight cats in the 70s. But Ernie came in, and within two or three takes, he just knocked off that solo. And when you hear a solo like that, you can't do the song and at least pay tribute to that solo. And that's what Patrick does most elegantly.
That he does. From the Live in L.A. album, Gino Vannelli, this is I Just Want to Stop. Four.
Get the sweetest thoughts of you and me. Memories of love above the city lights. It took so long to make it, but oh no, my heart just won't fake it.
Live in L.A., Gino Vannelli. I just want to stop. Gino, if you play that on Valentine's Day, you're going to have every woman in the place sighing. I love the slow pace, the tempo. You slowed the song down. It's just, it's an ultimate love song. It truly is.
Yeah, I mean, the little changes that we make it interesting for the boys to keep playing it and for me to keep singing it because, you know, Tom, I've been to a lot of shows of artists that I respected throughout the years. It's just a human, a normal thing to tire of your most famous songs. And the only way to make it fresh for the audience is, number one, always be committed, you know, to doing a good job. If not for the audience, just for yourself. But also to not be afraid to change it where you feel like there's something new about it. And when you feel there's something new about it, there's a bit of a hill to climb or a mountain even to climb. And you stretch. And the audience could feel that you're stretching. And that the act of stretching really means that you're there and you're involved. And that's what I like to be when I'm on stage, involved.
Gino, even though this was recorded in 1978, it's still just as fresh as it's ever been. This could absolutely be a hit on jazz radio right now. It's that fresh, that tight, and just such a fine groove.
That new version, yes, I agree.
You know, I wanted to break off the subject just a little bit. I was reading some stuff in your bio I did know about you. First of all, that you performed live with Stevie Wonder. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I was recording the Powerful People record. I was a little frustrated with myself, musicians, the studio. And so I needed to take a break. So I went back to my hotel and I decided to go by poolside and go in a chaise lounge. And I kind of fell asleep. And this is 1974. And I was awakened by a voice singing Crazy Life, which was the title track for my first album on A&M.
Right.
And I heard, it's a crazy life, hazy life. And I was saying, where's that coming from? And I know that song. So wait a minute, it's my song. And following the voice in the pool side, the pool area of this kind of strange motel that was on Sunset Boulevard, all the musicians stayed there, famous musicians at the time. It was a hang for all the famous musicians. And I think it was called Hallmark. And I traced the sound, which was the pool area is surrounded by the whole hotel. And so I finally found that it was Stevie Wonder, you know, singing Crazy Life.
Wow.
You know, and I was walking towards Stevie and his brothers kind of nudged him, said, there's the guy, you know.
That's a cool story.
You know, and he told me how much he liked that record. And I said, of course, you know, Stevie was at his thriving at his peak. You know, I think he just had finished Fulfilling This or something like that. And he just said, by the way, he said, Chaka Khan won't be able to make 7 or 8 concerts. Would you like to open for me?
Wow.
And kind of taken aback. And I said, you know, do you think, your audience will accept me? Am I going to be, you know, killed or what? And he said, no, he said, they'll love you, you know? And it really was a break for me, a big break for me. And so I opened up for Stevie, and Stevie was gracious enough many times in many cities to introduce me himself.
That's awesome.
And the thing that, you know, good luck always promotes other more good luck. When I was in Cleveland, I believe it was, or Cincinnati, I think Don Cornelius from Soul Train had heard that I was touring with Stevie. And at that time, People Got a Move, that silly little song, was just released, and it was going up, you know, the R&B charts. And Don Cornelius, coupled with the song going up the charts and touring with Stevie Wonder, I get a call in my hotel room, and I say, yes, and the guy says, this is Don Cornelius. And he asked me to do Soul Train. And I said, Don, I said, are you aware of me, who I am and all? He says, why? A white guy, you know? And he says, well, he says, here at Soul Train, we consider you off-white.
Oh.
And I said, I'd love to do it, but can I ask you one more favor? And he said, yes. I said, can I do a live version of People Gotta Move on your show? And he said, yes, anything you want to do. So if anyone wants to Google Gino Vannelli on Soul Train in 1974, you'll hear still a different version. It's a live version of People Gotta Move.
Great story. If you're just tuning in, Gino Vannelli's our guest on Songwriter Studio. Thank you so much for these great stories. I've got a couple of shout-outs to give. I know we've got people from around the country listening to the show tonight. Jim and Cindy Gerwitz, thank you for tuning in. My brother Dave from Missouri and Tony, thank you guys for tuning in to this Gino Vannelli interview. Gino, you're about to release your 21st or 22nd album. Why don't you expand on that and tell us the progress of the new project?
I believe, Tom, it's the 23rd. It's an album called The Life I Got. I'm almost finished. I have one vocal left and then mix it and it'll be out. It's going to be out on Sony Orchard. And again, a little example. For a while, I was, for some reason, Keep On Walking, which was recorded in 1975 off the Storm at Sunup album, was on my mind. And I decided to toy with it. And what would I do with that song now, you know, in 2023 when I was planning it? And I came up with a pretty interesting arrangement, and it turned out so nicely that my brother Ross said, I think we should release that as the first single track from the Life I Got record. And so we just did some video shooting, and so that will be the first release, Keep On Walking, from the new record. But the rest of the album, of course, is ultra personal. Most of it is dedicated to my beautiful, wonderful wife, Patricia, who I've been with since 1974.
Holy cow, Gino, that's... That's fantastic.
Yeah. It's the first kind of album of its sort for me, because I've never been really a great songwriter in terms of writing about things that I feel grateful for or about. I've never been one of those ultra positive, you know, there's always some kind of longing, yearning, that wanting of something that I don't have, that I... or some kind of reaching, or some kind of, you know, delving into some dark place that I need to come out of. But on this album, Life I Got, it really is a step or two back. And looking back at, you know, throughout all the years, the person I've been with, all we've been through, it's just my ability to write, I think, interesting songs would sing, life was and is still good.
You're a blessed man, Gino Vannelli. You certainly are.
Well, it's not an easy, you know, topic to tackle, because for the most part, you know, songs that really basically say life is good are not very interesting. It wasn't always that. But when you juxtapose that at times life was hard or very difficult or urgently bad, but all in all, life is good. Then the album starts to mean something. And songs like The Hero You See in Me and Stormy River. I mean, there's a bunch of songs in there. And The Life I Got, basically. I never thought I would be able to say, you know, I'm so grateful I was given the life I've got in a song. But, you know, after all this time, I said it wholeheartedly. And I like the song, too.
Gino Vannelli is our guest on Songwriter Studio. Some great stories. He will be performing, of course, February 14th, Valentine's Day, at Joe Flores's brand new venue, Ego Cuisine and Music. We're looking forward to hearing all these songs live. That being said, I want to go back to your Live in L.A. album and play the title track from your Black Cars album. This is the live version, keyboard-based, great pop rock song. This is just a superb version, originally released in 1984. Gino, why don't you give the listening audience a little heads up on this live version of Black Cars?
Well, let me give you, first of all, a little bit of background on how the song was written. It was 1983, and I had a really difficult time. I was blacklisted by Arista Records. They wouldn't release my stuff, and they wouldn't release me as an artist. So I didn't know what to do with my career after having, you know, lots of success in the 70s, a big album with Brother to Brother and a big album with Nightwalker. I found myself on the wrong side of someone's favor. And so I figured I got to do something different and go somewhere else. So I decided that I was going to do something very novel, a novelty song like Black Cars that wasn't a serious R&B or a blue-eyed soul approach. And I had this song that I'd written on the guitar. It had all the main lines, black cars look better in the shade, and the riff and all that. And I didn't really know what it was about. And I just couldn't finish it. So I went to my friend's house one night, Roy Freeland, and he didn't know either. Sometimes I wrote a co-wrote lyrics with him now and then. And he said, why don't you just go on Hollywood Boulevard, sit down and watch people go by? And he said, it might inspire you. So one day, it was pretty warm in Los Angeles. It was a warm day in May. And I sat on one of the benches on Hollywood Boulevard, watched people go by, sort of, you know, eccentric people, but it's sort of in a dull way. But then this one lady kept walking by at least 3-4 times. She had a black fake fur coat on, and it was warm. She was really had this kind of yarrow root white makeup, you know, that would really accentuate the lines in her face, dark glasses. And she looked like she was waiting to be discovered, but she was 30 years late. And I said, wow, that is an intriguing person. What kind of demons does she have just lurking within her? She was a sort of Gloria Swanson type in a way. Was the character in Streetcar Named Desire who's afraid of getting old or something like that. And I decided that's the person I want to write about. So I went home. I thought about her a lot. And I, at that time, I had a black Camaro Z28. And I kept trying to wax it and really polish it. And I noticed that every time I got to the shady side, it looked perfect. And every time I got to the sunny side, the scratches, the swirls would never go away. And it just dawned on me, that's exactly what she was. She was trying to avoid the sun because the scratches and the swirls would never go away. And so the song is not about a car at all. It's about this very unique person, tragic person, who had never been discovered. And that's what the song is about.
Gino, what a great song. Let's listen to that track from the Live in L.A. album. This is Black Cars.
Let's go to 1984.
She's a
cocktail gloves and strapless dress. She cuts a perfect silhouette, but she's a dark angel wearing dark glasses, a fading beauty as the nighttime passes.
Gino Vannelli live in L.A. with his classic Black Cars from 1984, title track. This is the live version, just stellar live version. You are going to be at Joe Flores's. Joe, how about a plug for the new venue? This is going to be a Valentine's Day, February 14th show. Go ahead.
This is going to be an awesome night. Of course, feature Mr. Gino Vannelli, I think. You know, I was so excited about booking this tonight. I mean, that night with him, because it's just, it's such a great night, Valentine's night. And I mean, you know, my God, you know, for all the ladies, what a show. Intimate Evening featuring Gino Vannelli. I mean, I've thought about this for a long time, and I think it's coming together. So I think it's going to be a beautiful night, a lot of good food, good venue. And, of course, we're looking so forward to Mr. Vannelli coming out. I know it's going to be a great show, and I hope everybody, if you miss this show, you're going to be missing a whole bunch. So please come out. I think it's going to be a great, great evening for everyone.
I'll be there. Lloyd will be there. We'll bring the wives. Gino, thank you so much for spending an hour with us on Songwriter Studio. Your new album, your live album, is just killer. I can't say enough about it. You've got another brand new album out coming shortly. I believe this is The Life I Got. Is that correct?
The Life I Got is coming out in April.
Okay, well, looking forward to getting a copy of that. And after you leave Houston, you're going to be in the Austin area playing at the Paramount Theater, and then off to Florida, and then over to Holland. I was looking at your schedule. You have got a busy 2024, Gino.
And we'll be back in Texas, though, in June, I believe, playing the Arlington in Dallas.
Oh, yes, the Dallas area. That's correct.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty busy, you know, and you know, the band could still do it. I could still do it. I'm still feeling good about singing and all those kind of things. And the moment I wouldn't do it. So we'll be there with bells and whistles.
I can't wait. We are really looking forward to the show. If you like what you hear on Songwriter Studio now in our 18th year, please continue to support KPFT and public radio. We love what we do here at KPFT. We are now in our 53rd year. I can't believe it. And appreciate all your support. And let's go out with Living Inside Myself. This was originally from my favorite album by Gino Vannelli, Nightwalker. Gino, why don't you give a heads up on this live version? This made it to number 2 on the charts, in the Canadian charts, back in 1981, I believe it was. And your vocals are just soaring on this track. Go ahead.
It's also a top 5 song in the United States. Gave me a gold record with Nightwalker. It's got another interesting, you know, people don't know the kind of shenanigans that go on before a record company, you know, wants to release a single. But when I handed in Living Inside Myself, the record company thought it was too complicated for a single release. And the president of the company at the time, Clive Davis, thought that the lyric was much too interior. Living Inside Myself. He says, find another hook line or find another title. He says, then we'll release it. And so I don't, you know, like to be a deadbeat or a poor sport. I said, I'll give it some thought. And so I spent a week thinking about it. And I remember asking various writers what they thought. And I, after a week of really giving it some deep thought, I went back to Clive and I told him, it is as it was, as it first came to me. It's called Living Inside Myself. And that's the arrangement. Do what you want with it. But I think it's a hit.
Wow.
So he did finally release it. So I give him that credit. He did release it. And it went up the charts. And I think it went all the way up to number two or three in the adult contemporary and number five or six in the pop charts in the United States. And it was pretty big for me all over.
You know, Gino, just before Joe asked me to do this interview, I was at home digging through a bunch of my old vinyl like I do occasionally. I love listening to my old vinyl. And I pulled out Nightwalker before this interview was even scheduled and played it cover to cover. It is one of my favorite records of all time, hands down. The title track is total masterpiece. My compliments. You are a tremendous songwriter, arranger, singer. You're the whole package. We are so looking forward to your show at the Ego on February 14th, Valentine's Day. Joe, thank you for joining us in the studio. Big thanks to Lloyd behind the glass for handling everything he does. Extra special thanks to Gino Vannelli for spending time with us on Songwriter Studio. Gino, is your website, do you have a ginovannelli.com site?
It's ginov.com, and we do have Facebook too and all that. We're full media.
Thanks again for joining us, and I really appreciate your time.
Pleasure, Tom. Pleasure, Lloyd. And Joe, look forward to seeing you there.
Same here, Gino. We're looking forward as well. So.
See you guys later.
Okay, take care. Thanks again.
Thank you, Gino. Stick around. Pete Little's up with the Iris Ayres Show. Always enjoyable every week. Let's go out with Living Inside Myself live, Gino Vannelli.
Felt so self-assured, but suddenly it's all changed. Ah, she's a cloud that hangs above my world, and I find myself wandering in the rain. so self-assured. But oh, how the seasons change. And now I'm not as strong, and I am lost, living inside myself, living inside this shell, living outside your love. I am lost, somewhere inside my own dreams, afraid of what life really means, living without your love. I am lost.
Ernie Williams.